Hello everyone, happy to see you. This is my favorite time of the day, Thursday, 7 p.m. Eastern time. You know why? We get to spend this time with our favorite people, with our favorite community, only here at Highland Park Lapidary. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Lizelle and I'm the Customer Service and Sales Manager here. I wanted to officially welcome you. We appreciate you for always taking the time to be with us on this call. Thank you very much. I wanted to welcome all our customers and all our followers that are streaming with us live, both on our Facebook and YouTube channel. Thank you for always tuning in. And we wanted to welcome and acknowledge our guests from the William Holland School of Lapidary Arts, all the teachers and the students as well there. I also see Bill Boggs here. Thank you so much. I love to see familiar faces on this call. Thank you so much for always being present. But we would love to meet new attendees as well. So I see a lot of new faces. If you are brand new, if this is your first or second time on this call, there is a chat icon at the bottom part of your Zoom. Please put new on the chat. We wanted to say hello and welcome you. All right. Ramsdell, hello from Illinois. Greetings from China and greetings from Boston, both from our CEO and general manager, respectively. Steve, welcome from Ohio. All right.
There's lots of Ohio guys on here.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think Dan Powers, this is the first time I see you. Welcome. And JD Crizel, welcome. I would love to have everyone turning on their camera as well so we get to see and meet all of you. Thank you so much. So our vision is to inspire massive global awareness, interest, appreciation, and participation in the lapidary arts. And I know we are sharing the same vision. This is why we are all in this call tonight. And that is to share knowledge, information, and expertise, to get tips and tricks, to do live Q&A, to network, and to collaborate as we learn new skills. And tonight, we are so grateful and so honored to have him for the third time to discuss the process of making inlay jewelry, silver construction, and gemstone inlay. Everybody, let's give some love on the chat to our guest speaker, no other than Chuck Bruce of the William Holland School of Lapidary Arts.
Hey, everyone.
Thank you, Chuck. And for your questions later, you can raise your hand by going into our reaction icon at the bottom part of your Zoom and click raise hand, or you can also post your questions via chat and we can queue that up on the video so all our followers can hear. Okay, so let's join our CEO, Jen Roland, and our general manager, Sherman Roland, together with Chuck Bruce to kick off our 35th live interactive webinar with our intro video.
We'll be right back.
Good evening, everybody, and good evening to you, or good morning to you, John, and good evening to you, Chuck, about ready to go into your big show this coming weekend. It goes all weekend, right, in Louisville?
Yeah, the St. James Art Fair, it's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We're supposed to have really good weather for it, so keeping my fingers crossed.
And we were just talking iPad 23, I think, who's from Ohio. Change your name. We got to know who you are. John and I are both from Yellow Springs, Ohio, of course. And we have lots of fond memories living in Ohio. Those beautiful, great summers, that kind of the smell and the June bugs. June bugs.
Fireflies. You got lots of fireflies.
So anyway, well, we got some terrific things for you tonight. Chuck has, as I spoke last week, totally over-delivered. Why don't we just talk briefly, Chuck, just what we covered last week. So if people weren't here last week, it is on YouTube, but basically, why don't you just speak briefly about what we covered last week, and then this will be kind of wrapping up the three-part series.
Yeah, we finished up the silver construction, so the box construction for the pendant, and then we went into the piecework or getting it inlaid. Where we broke off at was the glue in and then doing the cutback on it.
Yep.
Cutback and shaping and polishing.
Yep. Yep. And that's been super terrific. So certainly have your questions lined up. We just put in the chat the videos. So if you want to have access to those are links to the videos for part one and part two. What we'll be doing is the third part here. I was going to answer the question that that iPad had just asked, and that is the Intarsia machine, both in the 8 and the 6-inch. John, why don't you just give an update? Obviously, Bill Boggs has been a big part of that. Hopefully, I'll be able to go see Al Sassona pretty soon here because he was really behind the first 6-inch machine. Super cool dude.
Yeah, so building prototypes right now. So we just got the frameworks, the first two machines done. And we always build a prototype because you find out, you know, whether you're going to have any fit up problems or whether it's easy to assemble or disassemble. And we found a few little things I want to change, but all in all, they're looking really good. So I think I'll have probably, it won't be next week because it's a national holiday here. So everything's shut down for a whole week. So the following week, I'll have the first two machines assembled and we'll be able to play with them some. And then Bill, of course, we're going to do a call then. You can get a feel for it and give us some feedback.
Yep, that's terrific. All right. Well, let's, without any further delay, Joanna, let's go ahead and roll the first video.
So the first part. What I do is take my scribe, wherever I put it, and I scratch up this bottom side. And what you're doing, just like what you do with the green scrubby or the brown scrubby with the metal, you're giving that metal some teeth for the glue. So you're not completely depending on just the glue to keep hold. Now, what is nice on rocks and things along those lines is that, you know, there is already some porosity from the material. So especially if you're cutting on a diamond wheel. I have these fun little knives that I use to. This, when I did the glue up, I do on wax paper. It's easy enough to either grind it off or do what I'm doing now right now is scrape it off. And again, with water, it's gonna make it kind of come off anyways, but it makes it easier to do. In the Intarsia, you need to make sure the work is completely flat. In the piecework, you don't, because they're individual pieces, so you don't need to worry about that as much. What I'm going to do now is do the glue up. I usually do this on paper plates. In the travel side, I forgot the paper plates. Whatever you do that's either disposable, but at the same time, you keep the glue and you know what's going on. The reason saying keep the glue, you want to see the cure rate on that. And then I do a towel on myself. It's so easy sometimes to get in a hurry. You don't have equal parts of the 5-minute epoxy. And if you don't have equal parts, what's going to happen is that the glue won't set correctly. So I was doing a cufflink line with my production assistant at the time, Micah Kirby, which is a teacher here now. And we had a really good fit on the stones. And so glued them in, I was in a hurry, glued it in, we were getting ready for a show. When I went to cut on the stones started spinning. Well, trying to get that glue to cure out was hell. Trying to get the stone out because it was in there so well was hell. So again, take your time in this. And if you make a mistake, mistakes are part of the process on this. So this is 5-minute epoxy. This has screwed up a little bit on me because I've not been doing shows. Replaced it, it's still usable. That was the resin. And what I do is a little bit more hardener than I do resin. And again, glue is a consumable. You don't need to make like a lake, but at the end of the day, don't get stingy on the glue because that is what's doing part of this process. Now, when I have light colored stones, I wouldn't do this. But because I've got dark, I'm going to tint the glue with artist charcoal. I've had students tint the glue with eyeshadow. You can tint the glue, Native Americans do it with spices like cinnamon, sage, things like that. One of the tricks that I tell students that I stumbled on myself, if I'm cutting on a single stone, like this is dinosaur bone, what I do is pull off the sludge in the bottom, wick off most of the moisture, take that ground up rock, nobody's ever gonna know where your gaps are because you're the same color consistency. Another thing that you can do are Indian inks, non-alcohol, because the alcohol won't play with the glue real well. And again, but they tend to be a little bit brilliant colors. Again, I tend to go more the Native American or the rock sludge. Doing artist charcoal, because I have ebony, it's a fairly dark wood, I'm gonna use a good amount of charcoal. Again, just try to say, oh, do I have too much? Do I just need a little bit? Glues are now curing clear, and at one point they were yellow. And so just a tiny, tiny drop of charcoal, just a speck, would take that yellow to more of a silver color. Now this does set up within 5 minutes, and that's the bad part on that. So if you're doing multiple pieces, sometimes it might be better in the glue up process to do one at a time. You fill this whole channel. You want glue to squirt out the size. If you don't, what you've got is air pockets, and you'll have those voids then with those air pockets that you've got to fill or fix somehow. So again, glue is what's making this whole thing work. So I start this. I'm going to go get some paper towels because I wasn't quite prepared. And what I like, because of the bail on the back, is to turn this upside down. And then you push on that from the back side. You get a lot more downward force. You're not gonna break things, stuff along those lines. So this is what I've got. So you see where the glue squirted out. I'm down there really well because that was at a slight taper. It really expanded that sidewall to fit the form that it is. So you can leave the glue on. I tend to wipe off just a little excess. I don't get where I'm removing all that glue, but you don't see any joints at all. And so with this, that's the idea, is that you've got the piece in. Now there's two things that I do want to say that can hang you up. If your stones are too much of a taper, they're really extreme. If you accidentally knit the corner and you need to drop that down some, you're gonna have a glue void because you don't have the rock along that sidewall because you've got it in too far. The second thing is that in this pushdown method, do not like take a hammer to it. Do not, if you've got a soft stone like Larimar, turquoise, don't get excessively forceful to it. If it's not fitting squarely, go ahead and cut it, but know that ahead of time. So these little clips from Harbor Freight, a beautiful tool that then you set this aside, you let it cure up. And then what we do is when it's cured up, we go ahead and start cutting back. So what I did was remove most of the glue, but I'm gonna keep some for knowing when I can go ahead and move forward if I'm doing like a cuff. Different manufacturers have different times, cure times on their glues. So if you're getting your glue from Home Depot, which is, I think, Devon or Loctite, Lowe's is Loctite, or there. One brand is at one place, one brand is the other. This is Stickfast I get from a knife manufacturer. I absolutely love it. But on the back will tell you the cure time. So that can tell you how long that needs to set, you know, to be a partial cure, to be a 50%, to be a full cure. Again, you saw that I had everything out of my way. So for my working area, I didn't have any cross-contamination, is what I call it. In the initial mixing of the glue, it's going to be very runny. And so if you get things glued in and you do this sideways like this, your stones are going to fall out because of gravity. So be aware of how you lay things so you don't have that happen. So I'm still just a tiny bit tacky, but you see I'm getting just a little bit of transfer to me, but not much. You don't want to create a lot of air bubbles by whipping this, but you do want to make sure the glue is mixed well. Again, since this is your adhesion factor. When this cures enough, what I'll do, the minute I can put my fingernail in it and doesn't stick to me if I'm doing a cuff, I can start my next piece. If you're going to do multiple glues this, that's what you can do. Get your first piece glued in, because I hate doing pickups. So if you have three stones and two pieces of silver, it's five pieces to manage. And it just, I have dropsy sometimes, and it's just a pain in the ass. Sorry for my French, but it is. So I don't think there's anything else. I don't think you need to let this cure. But again, keep some residual glue back so you know if it's been a successful glue in. You know that your glue is going to adhere well. You're not going to get to the genie when you go ahead and cut this back, which we'll be doing tomorrow. Or it doesn't pull your silver out, you know, all of that. So thank you for being with us today. I hope this has been informative.
Let's actually get into some questions because we've got questions on glue here, Chuck. Carrie asked this actually last week. Did you say include which glue? And the name of that glue again, what it was in the video.
It's Stickfast.
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 Yeah.
And then
they have an accelerator.
Put that in the chat as well. I'm sure like Nermeen is looking it up right now. So Connie, that's your question as well. And then Connie had a question, mix powder stone with a glue to get the perfect fit. Is how that is done.
Well, it's not mix the glue. What it's to do is if you've got any slight voids. So fit is the big thing with inlay. If you've got any sidewall variations or things like that, it's going to show. So how do you minimize that eye draw to those voids, and it's doing a same color stone that you're fitting in. Now, you have to make sure that's finely ground up. If you've got like particles of gravel, of course, those are going to impede you going in. I don't wick it completely dry. What I found with the sludge or the ground up rock, if it's completely dry, it pours moisture out of the two-part epoxy and makes it really granular. And so you need just a tiny bit of water. It will take a little longer to cure because of that, but it's still a chemical process. So,
okay. All right. That's great. Ed had a question. Chuck, do you ever have a problem of the fit of the stone is so close that the stone won't go all the way down into the finding due to the viscosity of the epoxy in a close fit? The air pocket under the stone is preventing the stone from going all the way in.
Yeah, you can. That's one reason is if you can get the glue when it's the most viscous, it's going to act as a basically lubricant. The more that sets up, the bigger problem that's going to be. And if you've got a really tight fit that's knowing it ahead of time, maybe taking just a tiny bit more off that sidewall, you know, or that end piece. When it's pieced work, you're going to have a little less of a problem of that. But when it's one large piece, that's where it's going to be more of a problem.
So this would be where you'd go back when you're setting making sure you're giving yourself enough room there. And then with the mixing the glue with the stone, then you're hiding any of the potential void, maybe you undercut a little bit too much, that's going to be hidden and the eye's not going to be drawn to that.
Right, exactly.
Sherry Johnson had a question. You started with Intarsia piece here, so you glued it in as one piece. What differences do we need to be aware of if you glue one stone in at a time? That's a great question.
Is make sure they're butted up against each other really well. So the sides and the ends are at a slight taper, but where they match each other is a straight vertical. And you can also get those off when you kind of look at it holding the piece up. It should be a horizontal line going across. If you're meaning to do a taper or kind of at an angle, intentionally do it at that. I will say matching up the sidewall angles and the angles where everything fits together can be a painful process because you've added more complexity to the fit.
So your recommendation in general, or especially if you're a beginner, is pre-do your pieces together like you did, then go into the setting.
No, I would do them separately, but make sure everything matches up really well. So what you usually do instead, before you start gluing, you can do a dry fit on all of it, make sure it does, it sits down. If you've overcut just a little bit, you can bump up that gauge of the silver between them to take up some of that room. That's a great way of, you know, not getting caught up. Oh, it has to be 24 gauge all the time. You know, some pieces look better with this, you know, 18, 16 gauge. So,
right. Okay, that's great. Howard had a question. Do you use other dry pigment colors with your epoxy other than black?
Yes. Yeah. Mostly the stone. Like I have passed through that had some rose quartz and just the glue by itself wasn't popping. She ran down to the Dollar General and got some pink eyeshadow, put it in. We didn't have a problem with the glue at all. And that really made that rose quartz pop. So, especially with pink glue behind it.
It's kind of funny. That's cool. MJ had a question. What viscosity works best for this type of project?
If you're doing a single piece, very, very fluid. If you're doing piece work, you can take a little bit more time where that glue is starting to get a little tacky. But the bigger thing is if you're going to glue those in as separate little stones, get all the glue out of the void where the other stones are going. Usually what everybody does is a dry fit, start with the top stone or, you know, the left-hand side, stones, silver, glue between the stone and silver, next stone, more glue. And then, you know, on the final piece, make sure that final piece goes in a little easier. And then double check when you're pushing that last one down, it doesn't pop out the other two. So,
right. Okay. And then Tad had a question. Suggestions for inlaying stones into another stone like marble where it is ground out like a tabletop for making designs. So,
So I have not done that process myself. There's two different ways you can go on that. Is that you're going to need to make sure those sides are true or however else. The other thing you can do, what I have had experience with, is taking up not the really ground stone, but more of a crushed stone and laying that in and then wicking in CA glue, which is, you know, like a super glue, but it's made for lapidary. And it won't yellow or become brittle with time. And that's the easier way to do some of those, doing the inlaying of those patterns.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Great. Well, that's, Joanna, let's go ahead and roll the next video.
The pendant has already been glued up, cured overnight, is then doing the cut back and the polish, and then do the final polish on the metal. So again, the examples are showing some variations. And one of the things that I always tell my students, and for my own self, is get rock that is beautiful in your mind or excites you. Inlay is all about the rock at the end of the day. So with this, these are just variations of what I've done. A couple of them are teaching examples. So we're gonna start putting this back on the genie. Again, the current pendant that we are working on is dinosaur bone and ebony. With this, what we're gonna do is do just a general shaping. Now, these guys do not have to be rounded. They can be flat. They can do what you want. This, I'm going to do a little bit of a barrel vault. I like some curvature. I'm just going to go from up and back, switch it over to the same thing. I'm going to stay off of the ends currently. It's really easy to overcut the ends and they look a little off. So again, sorry about the noise. Always have good light. Again, good safety. You've got something spinning, nothing on your wrist. Elbows in, hands up, and it's more of this motion. I'm starting with the 220. Now, this is not cutting as quick as I want to. What you do is just an angle down. You slide against that space. And what I'm doing is creating just that initial, what I consider, hip. Now, you do not try to come down on the sidewall metal. We will on the 280, but not on any of the diamonds. So I tend to be heavy-handed on the right hand, dominant hand. So I switch to make sure things are evened out. Again, some cutting is as much about feel as it is anything else. So I've got a beautiful start for this. If you look at the end. Still have a little bit more here that I want to take down. Just a tiny bit. A little bit more here that I want to take down. You can start to see how this is going to come together. Again, always bring your light in. It's something I go around the room doing for students time and time again. You cannot really see unless you've got that light where that stone is contacting with the wheel. Again, that's just basic kind of stone cutting, but it's so easy not to do that. See how my refining is going? And not actually too bad. So, one of the nice things about taping the metal off, having it pre-polished, it gives you something to hold on to. I have an alternative method if you're doing something along the fat lines also. So all I'm doing is pre-shaping that in. I can also do the other side from the reverse. I find that I like to pull it toward me because I can see what's going on. It's so easy to go through the other and not know how much you cut off. So I'm starting to get initial rounding. This is considered a little bit more of a barrel, and if you think of it, you can understand why on that. Now I'll be reducing the height some. Again, nice, easy, long stroke. That's one thing in polishing stone cutting. The less choppy your strokes can be in this, the better it's going to have from a surface feeling even instead of all choppy. Now we are on a diamond wheel. It's going to create flats. There's nothing you can do about that. The Nova wheels being resin is where you start then to change up what you've got going on. So in this, you see how this is starting to come together. Once I get this polished, I think this is going to be gorgeous. I'm going to take down just a little bit more and then switch on to the other wheel. The cutting back should actually go fairly quick. Again, most of your labor is into doing the inlay part, or the piecework is what I call it. So I'm switching over to the 280. I always have a towel on my lap too to dry things off. Just to see where I'm at with scratches and things. Again, I know instinctively anymore how I'm doing. You can see how this is starting to come together. So we will come down onto the metal this time. You don't want to stay on it really badly, but you want to make sure that transition between the stone and the metal is seamless. I do a lot by touch, by feel. Okay, I have to close my eyes. It's a great way to know how your transitions are going. 280 is on the newer side, so it's cutting really well, which is not a bad thing. Just again, depending on the age of your wheels, how they're cutting, will determine how hard to press in, how hard not. So what I'm doing is, again, crisping up these edges. I'm coming just along the edge of this wheel.
and doing just a light touch to get this what is considered both pre-polished and cut back any diamond scratches there could be from the diamond wheel since they're hard and a little bit more aggressive. I've always hit on the silver, and what I'll do is come along and blend this transition later on. So we're going to move from the 280 down to the 600. Wanted to get you a good look at this right now. So the gentleman I learned cabochons from 18 years ago, Nestor Garcia, lovely, lovely man, but he was a fanatic on things being polished well. Your edges had to be crisp, there no scratches. He liked me, which he could dog you a little bit if he didn't think you were putting in enough effort. But I always say that, you know, sometimes the people that are the hardest on you from a teaching standpoint sometimes of making you do a high level of craft are the best learning experiences. So I'm going to switch to the 600. The 600 is considered a still shaping wheel or refining the shape you've got going. Also what's considered a pre-polish. We'll go from 600, 1200, 3000. And from that, we'll be jumping over to mechanical polishing to do the metal. So get this started up again. So what we're gonna do is fill that hand action by doing this. I do wanna re-emphasize to come along, do that slide along the face of this to hit in this area. Same thing here. And again, since I know that I'm heavy-handed on the right side, I reverse things just so I can keep things even up. Bad part with not doing the slide or being consistent on rotating things, you don't know if you're going to have that whole surface touched by that wheel and do what it's supposed to, is refining the polishing process and removing scratches. So again, along the edge of this wheel, I also want to do just a small blend on that silver. So I'm coming along that, again, edge work. Across that. I still want to blend out that top edge, make it quite nice sharp. I'm not putting much pressure on there at all. I don't need to. All you're doing is trying to keep that edge from basically breaking off, and all you're doing is a slight softening there. I've got a little bit of a white matrix happening, which pulls the eye a little bit. At the end of the day, I think it adds to it. You could, if this bothers you, is cut it back. There's some stones that optically throw your eyes from a cutting standpoint. And again, just trying to make sure that you've got the same shape. I see that I'm a little out of round here on this right-hand side. He's still sticking up a little bit. I'm actually not bad here. I could probably take it down a little bit. So what I'm going to do is make sure I refine this. If I have to step back, I will. Sometimes just putting a little bit more pressure on this actually does the job. Again, knowing your machine, knowing your wheels is actually very helpful. So. So I'm putting more pressure on that left side just to refine that back. Since that is ebony, a little softer, it's actually doing what I want. In these things, again, a lighter hand sometimes is a little better, especially if you don't want to overcut. So I'm liking how D looks. On the dinosaur bone, I'm going to have to put just a little bit more pressure. And this actually shows that on the right-hand side, I was a little heavier than I was on the left. And I actually like how he's come in. So. Progression to the next wheel. Get your light in so you can see the slide. Come on, quick walking. Sometimes if your machine has a little bit of vibration, it'll walk. It's better to walk. Same action.
round like I want, make sure I'm round like I want, a little bit of edge work, a little bit of transition. So I'm a person about functional wearable art. You can have what's considered high art or something that makes a statement, but my background from interior design and fashion merchandising, how does it fit into somebody's daily life and is it usable or wearable? This point along here, I've got a good visual eye to see if I've got scratches or stuff. If you are new to this, definitely dry things off, take a look to see where you're at. I have just a little bit of surface pitting from the dinosaur bones that I can, after the fact, which in the class I teach you how stabilization and doing surface treatment. This one we're just going to progress through. You are dealing with natural stones, and so that at the end of the day is what it's about. Along that edge, along that edge. I'll do my edge work first. Do that softening of that. I'm going to reverse it just to make sure. Now the 3000 is a polish wheel. That is what the Zinis and the Catsings come with. You can actually get higher grip wheels for polishing, which is what I have at home. At the end of the day, depending on your work and your needs, depends on what you should really get for your shop or for yourself. Again, the striking, just rolling it back to myself. Now this 3000 is a little worn in, so I can put more pressure on it. If you're using softer stones and you have new wheels, break those in with a hard agate. Otherwise the softer wheels will just get scratches. So of course the ebony is going a little quicker than the dinosaur bone. Again, soften this edge. Soften this edge. And all you're doing is where you've already softened it, you're polishing it. You're refining what's going on. Okay, we'll go ahead and take the machine down. So my personal philosophy, because I had also another instructor here at William Holland, Howard Siegel and Terry in casting, and I had a ring that I was all proud of, and I took to Terry, and I said, what do you think of this? And he goes, do you want my honest opinion? I said, yeah. He goes, okay, you've got a rough edge here. I need to polish this more. Made me feel about 2 inches tall by the time he got done. But it was a good experience on finishing. Part of this process in making things is the finishing process. So having a critical eye and seeing what you need to do. So this is what we've got. Just a tiny bit of surface pitting that, like I said, in my class, I show you how to take care of. But we've got a great shape, great polish on the stone. The wood is a little on the dull side. It's gonna happen. Again, we've got a couple of tricks to bring that out, which I'm gonna move on to next. This is, in my mind, a little bit more of a barrel vault. But again, if somebody is wearing this, they're gonna be doing this daily, running their hands over everything else. And so you don't want any sharp edges.
Dude, that is super cool. Like just watching your whole technique, like the subtleties. Are folks in the chat, are you learning technique? Because as Chuck's going through that, he's showing you how he's thinking about that, where he's picking up that edge, the blending. Connie's like, yeah. I mean, this is part of the real value you get working with people like Chuck that are really masters in their whole field. And, you know, if you go to study at William Holland, or should I say when you go to study at William Holland School of Lapidary Arts, you're going to have this for a week for any of the programs, whether it be with Bill or with Chuck or Micah or any of the other terrific instructors, or you're going to learn so much about how to think about things, and it'll take years off of your learning curve. That's one of the things I learned just so much of watching your video. Let's go to the next video just for the sake of time. Let's roll the next video, Joanna.
The wheel that's on this is system only on this side, if you read it. This is a little worn, but I'm going to use it. One of the tricks that you can do with stones and wood is do a separate buffing wheel that is only used for the surface of the stone, and you're only on it for a light kiss and just a second. But what it does is bring up that level of surface on both the stones and the wood, you know, really respond well to it. So it's gonna be a little noisy. Sorry on that. Heavy, heavy Zephyr Zam. I prefer Zam myself. Just my final polishing choice. Again, I'm doing the same thing, coming across that edge. Just a kiss. A lot of compound and a really light hand. All you're doing is trying to raise that surface and don't let it catch like it just did on me. I haven't had enough caffeine this morning. It's Labor Day. I slept in. So right now we've got compound, but you can see where that wood has just taken that and run with it. So I'm going to go straight Dawn, pull out that compound, and then come back and polish the metal. When you've got something that is wax-based, what you really want to do is make sure that you remove things with just straight Dawn. A lot of people do, you know, Dawn and water, but the water washes off the Dawn. If you've got old mechanical toothbrushes that you aren't using anymore, what they do for your teeth, they actually do good for things like this. Get some hot water and battery get out on this one. Yeah, get that in this one. Okay, so we'll do it the old-fashioned way. I always say Murphy's Law, you know, you get things set up and then things want to go sideways just a little bit. I have found with any of the polishing compounds that cold water just does not get it to break loose. You have to do a lot of muscle job if you don't have hot water in your studio. So something to think about when you go to do your studio, if you're doing it like in the garage or on a back porch, that sometimes having water is helpful. Gonna dry this real quick. And I'll peel off the tape in a minute. I want you to see the stone once this is stone and wood, once this is dry. So you can see how that dino bone kind of pops. In the where I talk about doing a final finishing on this, we would use just a little bit of Star Bond or kind of a CA glue that's for Roxette on the wood. What that'll do is fill in these guys, come back, do a final polish on the wheel. We do the same thing on the wood. Again, there's a lot of ways to trick things out. Oops. I usually have a separate wheel and I didn't this time. So what I'm gonna do now is actually do the metal. Tape comes off. And then what you've got is, again, like Christmas. Now, you could run with this. I like the sidewall just a little bit more bumped up. And polishing is going to refine that edge between the wood and the stone. Or the metal and the stone. Get my mouth and my actions working at the same time. So I have a trick. Let me show you on this. When you mechanically polish, it is hard to hold on to rings and things. The easiest thing you can do to help yourself out is do a safety. So a piece of heavier gauge wire is a great one that if this catches, it's going to pull it straight out of your hand. But it gives you an additional support mechanism. I do a lot of mechanical polishing and I do it well. You also have to think about safety sometimes. And I do this myself. It's just a trick that I learned just by me thinking it through one time, and it just makes it easier. So I'm coming at an angle. And again, at an angle so that you're not square with that wheel. If you're doing just a real light touch, you can be square with. You can see the difference that makes just in that sidewall profile. Again, this is part of the finishing process. And like I said, the front stone, when you look at the other examples, I'll be tricking that out at home, but not in my own studio. And sometimes you don't always have the things with you that you need to do things. I do have things like this in the classroom when I go to show final finishes. This video was more just to get you an understanding of inlay. And coming down on the side, since we're using the same wheel, just a little bit on that. Okay. So this is where we're at on this. I will wipe this off with a t-shirt. A lot of people don't realize that when you use a terry cloth towel, you put scratches in. Paper towels contain wood pulp, you put scratches in. If you're gonna come to what's considered a mirror finish on the metal, why put scratches back in if something you've just polished?
Why don't you roll the next video, Joanna, as well?
One trick that I learned from Jim Richardson, which I wish he would have taught me years before, but you know, we find out when we need to sometimes. For the back bail, one of the things that I learned from Jim is called thromming. I'm gonna go ahead and wipe this down with a little bit of t-shirt. And so thromming is an old-time kind of jewelry solution and things like that, is you take cotton, it has to be 100% cotton, and you put compound and hold the string. Just load this up with compound, whatever compound. So if you want to do a pre-polish with bobbing compound, white diamond, or whatever you use, I only use bobbing compound and Zam myself in my own studio. But you're able to get in these areas that are really, really tough to polish. Again, Jim is the one that showed me. It was a wonderful piece of, something to add to my toolkit. And again, at the end of the day, take what you need and kind of leave the rest. So all you do is, like a guitar string, you run this along underneath the back of this. Those areas are so hard to polish. Now, in the tumbling process, it will have done a fairly good job of getting in there, but you always can get things popped up along these lines. So, you know, you can see definitely from how much brighter that is. Now, the rest of this, I can come back on the wheel and just lightly polish. At the end of the day, though, if you get too aggressive, you're going to take off some of that texture. And that's where that fine line is of knowing a skill set and everything else. I'm going to go ahead and pop it up, and then we'll be done with this segment of the portion. So, it's just a real light touch. Again, you don't want this to get grabbed. And all I'm doing is trying to brighten that metal just a little bit. More dawn on this, dry it off, and we will be at the end. So one of the things I forgot to say yesterday was my experience coming here. I have a background in interior design and fashion merchandising from Indiana State University. I also, have a talent of seeing things in my head, of the way things are going to look coming together. I find that is rare. I'm always adding to my skill set. And at the end of the day, I enjoy what I do. I am a working artist, though. I do art fairs extensively, and I also teach nationally at various places. Teach for the Eastern Rock and Gem Federation. I teach for the Southeast Rock and Gem Federation, Redux Art Group, Studio JSD, Berea Tourism Office. And so with that, my goal is to pass on my tricks and my love of the art that I do. So then you can see where we're at with this.
I have a little bit more refining I would do on this, honestly, with just, you know, doing the little pits on the stone and things like that. Again, finishing is part of the process. If you take my class, I'm on for 8 weeks next year, maybe 9. Remember to have the joy in the learning. We always forget that you're doing something new. End product, I want you to be proud. I'll get you to a high execution. But learning and that experience should be joyful. So thanks for being with us. Bye.
That is so cool, dude.
That's great.
Thanks.
So we have a couple of questions Connie, you win the question award. Like, I love Connie because Connie's going to ask the questions and that's super valuable. Yeah. Connie, you said, Connie had a question that was actually for Christine, but Christine's not here. She's like, had you thought about taking classes on the road? Now you teach around the country. So, and I think that would be the case for some of the other instructors too, that they're teaching in different locations around the country. So you may want to look at that. Do we have a link to, I think we have your website. That does your website have also the different areas that you're teaching, Chuck?
Yes, it does. And I've also got tentative for 2023. I just added a knife inlay workshop and also an one-day earring workshop for Studio JSD, which is not on the website yet.
Okay. Yeah. So we just put the website up there in the chat. And certainly y'all should bookmark that because you're seeing the quality of that Chuck's work. I mean, you learn so much from him. Connie also had a question. Are there any tricks to treat the stone and wood without getting it all over the metal?
So with the stabilization or filling those pits, you put CA glue on doubled wax paper. If you do single, you can glue it to your surface. And I had that happen. You pick up like a watercolor artist with a toothpick and basically have a controlled application. I also have found that Japanese or really nice Q-tips that are really tightly wound, you can also do a method with that of a surface application.
Okay. And then do you ever get compound in the cracks and bugs, and how do you remove it if you get like the compound in those areas?
That's where the hot water and a good toothbrush. But if you can actually, before you get to that stage, is fill those, which I normally would do this, video is just a little bit backwards from what I normally would do. The other thing is, if you get that, you can come across the highest polishing wheel you have, and that also helps clean those out because you've got the water and everything else.
Right. And I remember, John, you've done a lot of dyno bone as well. What has been some of your techniques for stabilizing the surface of those?
Well, what I would do, like when I do bone spheres, when I finish the grind, because when you're diamond grinding on bone, even then you're going to get iron cutting. So when I would get to I would get through, I think, 400 metal, then I would treat the whole sphere with Bond Optic and a light coat where you're not leaving clumps and big blobs on. So just get it soaked into the surface, and then you come back with your, I would do a 400 poly then, because the poly is not very aggressive cutting, because you don't want to cut all the way through what you fill, obviously. Yeah. And then you get a really great finish, a mirror finish.
Okay. Yeah. Because I know I've seen some of your work, and some of your cabochon work is also just remarkable without, you know, like a lot of people struggle with if they're doing using cerium and leathing on bone, that you'll have the residue of cerium. Yeah. So,
yeah. And that's why I use a 50,000 wheel myself, especially wet, because I'm too heavy handed with tin oxide and cerium oxide. I just put scratches in because I let it get too dry.
Gotcha. Steve had a question. What's the difference between ZIP versus ZAM?
ZIP is done by Eurotool. I don't know if I don't think they're exactly the same ingredients. And for myself, when I'm using for, and I normally don't like do the silver and the stone on the same wheel, because all the black that you see is carbon and silver bits and stuff like that. But I get a better result with ZAM, and Rio Grande has that. I'm also sure a couple other people supply that also.
Yeah. Okay. And then Tony had a question. Wouldn't continuing with diamond abrasion series 8,000, 4,000, 50,000 have polished a larger stone better? I think you actually spoke to that, but why don't you answer that question?
Yes, it would. And that's what I have in my own home studio. I've got where I've only got two wheels per arm because of doing knives and things. It gives me a little bit more room to work. And then I go all the way up to 50,000. And I still do a ZAM, a final ZAM. Now, when you're teaching the classrooms, you don't always have that luxury. So what I'm trying to do is get people to what they have probably available themselves. And then how can you do a final trick out on that?
Gotcha. Okay. No, that's very, very good. Well, you know, your generosity in shooting such comprehensive detailed videos, certainly appreciate it. I know somebody in the chat was saying they're loving that they can go back and actually see the videos and review it. Connie had made a comment in the chat, which I think is a real important one, is that you can watch a video a lot of times and you can learn that, but that's not going to be the substitute of having somebody like yourself who's there mentoring and coaching you about watching you, because sometimes we can learn but not necessarily embody that which we see. And I think that's where the coaching comes in. Do you want to speak a little bit to that, because you've also studied with a lot of teachers and how that's impacted you versus just, you know, learning on your own?
For myself, I do better when I'm with somebody. Part of it is you can ask the questions right then and there. When you're watching a video, you can't. What I also, for myself, I teach, take a class two times. First time, there's a hell of a lot of information thrown at you, new techniques and everything else. Second time, it usually locks it in. And then for myself, you know, inlay can be scary because, you know, it is labor intensive, especially from the piecework. And so, you know, I act as the cheerleader in the classroom when somebody's like taking on a full inlay cuff, is yes, you can. And, you know, they can get frustrated, they can get angry, the cutting goes sideways during it. And in those times, you either laugh or cry. What I tell everybody is, are you Superman? Are you Superwoman? How many hours a day are you spending on this? How long have you been doing it? You know, at the end, give yourself a break for what you're attempting. And we can get you there. But it might take a little bit more time than you planned on. It will be a little challenging sometimes. But at the end, when they see finished work, you know, and especially then taking it through the final polish process of both the metal and the stones, you know, that's where the smiles come in. That's where the joy comes in. And again, we can always up our game, but you've taken on something that watching a video is not going to give you the same thing. You'll get frustrated partway through and thought, okay, the hell with this. I'm not doing it anymore. So.
Well, with that being said, team, put up the thing for the Holland, William Holland School Lapidary, the QR code, and then also put the links up on the website. So we encourage you, like the school is the best value at $495 for a week with room and board and food and amazing instructors that also are volunteering their time. So they don't get paid to go teach at the school. This is really their commitment to take their knowledge and make it available to you. You could not afford, you couldn't pay Chuck $495 for a week of time to teach you. Like that's like a one-on-one, that's just not gonna happen. He's going there for the love of it, and that's really important. So we encourage you, take advantage of this, and also put Chuck's information up here. So you follow Chuck. I mean, and if you're in the Kentucky, Ohio, Indiana region, you know, take time to go see his work in person. He's right there in Louisville, Kentucky. What's the show that you're doing right now?
The St. James Art Fair is actually 5 shows in one. It's in the top 10 of shows in the nation. St. James Original, Belgravia, 4th Street, 3rd Street, and then I'm in the 1300 professional section.
Yeah, so if you're anywhere close to the Louisville region, definitely go see Chuck, see the work that he's been displaying there. It's going to be a real good time. And then team, put up the link. Like one of the things when we're doing these things, we're really working to provide a resource for you all to have access to teachers and knowledge. So if you like this, give us a review, give us a 5-star Google review. That makes us super happy. Like, believe me, when the reviews come in and I see them on my phone, I'm like, okay, this was worthwhile doing this, all the work. Cause we have our team working, they're shooting video. We're paying people to put this all together. Most of everything that Chuck shows, we actually don't sell other than like capping machines. At least not yet. So we definitely appreciate the positive reviews. That really makes us excited. And then also subscribe to the YouTube channel. You know, as these videos go up, you'll get a notification that there's a new stuff. We're really aiming to produce the most comprehensive library of lapidary education that's available for people free on the internet. So this really exposes people to instructors like Chuck so that they can really get launched into the lapidary hobby, whether they're new to it, whether they're a seasoned pro. We definitely want that. And certainly in the chat with Chuck, show him some love. Like he's three times he's been here. So in the chat, you know, say your thanks to him, because this is clearly a big commitment. And, you know, certainly you saw that with Bill Boggs. You saw that with everybody else that we've had on here, is they've really committed themselves to deliver value to you. And so we really appreciate you being here, Chuck. And here you're at a show too. And even at the show, you know, probably, you know, you're the Micah and others are setting up and you're here doing a webinar, you know, so we thank all the support from them too.
Micah and I are sharing a booth. So he will be at the 1300 professional. They saw us at Kentucky Crafted like 7 years ago and said, "Hey guys, you need to do our show." So we're able to share booths. And so his electro etching usually does really well. And my inlay work does well. So
That's terrific. Well, we appreciate you taking time with us this evening. Yeah. And we'll look forward to seeing all of you next week. And certainly the link will go up for this, for a replay. I've had a number of people tell us like, oh, now that video's up, I can go back to that part that I've stuck on. It really has helped them. But we definitely encourage you, check out the William Holland School of Lapidary Arts. It is the best value. And you're going through, I think, November, right? Classes are through November?
Yes. Beginning of November? It's the first full week of November. So I'm there October 23rd and 30th, which then rolls in a little bit. And then the next week is the very last week.
Very, very good. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you all for joining us tonight. And thank you, Chuck, for all the work that you've done here. This is terrific. All right. Thanks, well, we'll see you all. Yeah. Good night.
Bye, guys. Good night.